how do we translate that oscillation theory into a wave theory? This is where we're going to do internal waves. Just like we had before, we have gravity oscillations in the vertical. We want to consider how that translates into horizontal movements of waves, or vertical movements of waves. What we'll do is we'll just write down the equations. Linear dynamics, we'll take away the rotation, so no worries about the Coriolis force this time. We're at small scales, so we can ignore the Coriolis force. And we're going to allow vertical acceleration. That's something different. There are various ways to specify the density of the fluid, but basically what we want to do is to say that the fluid has a certain density, which is a basic density, plus a density which is a function of z, plus some small perturbation to do with the wave movement. This basic stratification is what's important in this problem. If this basic stratification is very small compared to the actual density of the fluid, then that's called a Boussinesque fluid. If it isn't, if it's quite important, then it's called an anelastic fluid. So, generally speaking, the ocean is a very good Boussinesque fluid. The vertical variations of density are quite small compared to the density. The atmosphere is not. Vertical variations of density in the atmosphere are order one compared to the density of air. And yet, in fact, it turns out that Boussinesque approximations work pretty well in the atmosphere as well for large scales. But anyway, what we're interested in here is the stratification, right? And so we specify that as n squared is minus g over rho d by dz of this basic state density. And we're looking for solutions for the perturbations, rho prime, and the other variables, u, v, and w, and pressure. Yeah. So we've got five unknowns, well, five variables, the three components of the velocity, the pressure, and the density. And we've got five equations. We've got the x momentum equation, linear, there's no advection terms, and no rotation. So it's a very simple equation. It's just the acceleration depends on the pressure gradient force. The y momentum equation, the z momentum equation, what we've just spent a long time talking about, that's the net buoyancy force gives the vertical acceleration. That term is what's new. Up to now, we've considered hydrostatic fluids. This is not hydrostatic because it's got some vertical acceleration. And then continuity, and this is the density equation. So the rate of change of density depends on the vertical advection of the basic state stratification. So that's a linear term because it's just got W there, and this rho bar is part of the basic state. All these terms are linear, right? So how do we solve that? Well, I'm not going to show you the details. It's the same procedure we used before. Basically, what we say is that solutions look like this. So it's e to the I times Lx, My, Nz. So L is the wave number in the x direction. M is the wave number in the y direction. And N is the wave number in the z direction, the vertical wave number. So that's a wave which propagates in three dimensions, omega t, omega is the frequency. Stick that solution in for every one of these variables, u, v, w, rho, and p. Okay, so just like before, we'll have coefficients. U is equal to u tilde times e to the I, all that stuff. V equals v tilde times e to the I, all that stuff, etc. And if we put those solutions into these differential equations, what comes out is algebraic equations, right? Linear algebraic equations which contain the coefficients, u tilde, v tilde, etc., contain geophysical parameters, so n squared and g, for example, and contain information about the waves, so that'll be L, M, N, and omega. So you'll get a 5x5 matrix of coefficients. The condition for having non-trivial solutions to that is that the determinant of that 5x5 matrix is zero. So you just find the determinant of that matrix, set it equal to zero, and do a few pages of algebra, and you get this, right? Now this is the dispersion relation for internal waves. And I've just marked that this, the non-hydrostatic term, leads to this part of the denominator, right, which is important. Okay? So if you follow that through in your working, you'll see that the reason why this part of the denominator is there is because you had that term. If you cross that term out, this will disappear. So in a hydrostatic fluid, then, the frequency depends on the stratification and then just the aspect ratio of the waves. However, if you have this non-hydrostatic term, then it's more interesting because it means that you can have actually waves of a large vertical extent, because n, the vertical wave number, can get smaller and smaller, and it won't lead to a catastrophe in the frequency. If it's hydrostatic and large in vertical scale, then this frequency will just go to infinity and you'll just get locked into rigid hydrostatic balance, right? Immediately equilibrated to hydrostatic balance. If you have this term here, then you can have large vertical scales, so small values of n, and the frequency will not go to infinity, it will go to n, because you'll have the same thing on the top and the bottom here. Let's just recap that. The frequency is lower than or equal to n, so the maximum value of the frequency you can have in this non-hydrostatic case is n, the Brunt-Weissler frequency. What else can we say? If you have a large horizontal scales, that means that little n is much bigger than L squared plus m squared. That means you have a low frequency. If you have large vertical scales, so little n is very small, as we've just said, then omega will tend towards n and you'll have buoyancy oscillations in the vertical. This denominator, as I said, comes from the non-hydrostatic term. What else can we say about this dispersion relation? It's actually a very exotic dispersion relation. And one thing you can do, you can break it down geometrically. So I'm going to draw the wave vector now. Well, I'm going to have to rub out this beautiful decoration here. Let's just draw a picture in 3D space. You got me? This is the vertical direction. This is the horizontal x direction. And here's the horizontal y direction. So we'll call that z, x, y. Okay, so there's a kind of 3D picture here I'm drawing. And the three wave numbers associated with that are L, okay, M, so L, M, and N, right? On the horizontal plane, you can draw the resultant of those two wave vectors, right? Ah, love it. And let's call that KH, K horizontal, right? And then let's just resolve that. I'll do it in a different color. Let's just put up a vertical from there to this value of n, and then the total wave vector K will look like that, all right? Now the angle in the vertical between this K vector and the horizontal, so this angle here, let's call it theta, and then this angle, this horizontal angle between the horizontal vector KH and L, let's call that phi. Right? So that's the way it's broken down. And so you can see that to start with, n is k sine theta, right? And then L is kh times cosine phi, right? Kh is k cosine theta. So L will be k cosine theta cosine phi. Right? It's all written down here, okay? So we have L equals k cosine theta cosine phi, m equals k cosine theta sine phi, and n is k sine theta, right? If you take all that and you substitute it into the dispersion relation and fiddle around a bit, you'll get a lot of sine squared plus cosine squared equals 1, a lot of things dropping out, and in the end you'll get a dispersion relation, very simple, that omega is equal to plus or minus n cosine theta. Now that's remarkable. It's a very exotic and simple dispersion relation with a really strange result, right? The result, think about it, what does this mean, right? It means that if you know the stratification and you know the frequency of the wave, then you know what angle it makes with the horizontal. So for a fluid with a given stratification n, what that means is that if you know the frequency, so let's say it's forced at a certain frequency, then you can predict where it's going to go. You can predict the angle it's going to make with the horizontal. The frequency depends on the vertical angle. Excitation at a certain frequency will lead to angled rays, and you can calculate the angle of the ray. Okay? So that's one weird and exotic feature of internal waves. There's only two things you need to know. There's the stratification of the fluid, that's a geophysical parameter, and there's the forcing frequency, or the frequency of the wave. And if you know those two things, you know where it's going to go.